Hello, everyone, and welcome to this information session on the Columbia River Treaty Agreement in Principle. My name is Brooke McMurchie, and I work with the Province of British Columbia Columbia River Treaty team, and I'm pleased to be your host for tonight. I'd like to acknowledge the territories of the Tanaha, the Shwetmik, and the Sioux Okanagan nations that extend across the Columbia River Basin. I can see that there are over 100 of you listening in right now. It's great to see so many familiar faces from both sides of the border in the BC Basin, in the US and elsewhere. Many of you have been involved in or followed the Columbia River Treaty for many years. And I know the modernization process means a great deal to you. The Columbia River Treaty and all the issues attached mean a great deal to many of you. And we're all very grateful that you're here. This session is being recorded and will be available afterwards to watch and share. So if you know folks who weren't able to attend, they'll be able to watch the session afterwards. So before I turn the stage over to the presenters, I'd like to take a minute to share how this session will go. We're going to start with an overview of Canada-US negotiations and the agreement in principle, as well as how we got here and some next steps in the process. We're then going to move into the details of the agreement in principle under the themes of flood risk management, Canadian flexibility, hydropower and transmission, compensation, ecosystem health, and Indigenous values. We'll pause for questions after each section, and there'll be time for questions at the end as well. Before we wrap up, I'll share next steps in our engagement process, and then we'll adjourn. So to ask questions during this session, we ask that you please type them into the Q&A box in your Zoom window. Please don't type in questions in the chat. We're not monitoring for questions there and they will be missed. Folks who have phoned in, you can raise your hand. Actually, everyone can use the raise hand function if they like. And if you have phoned in, you can raise your hand by pressing *9 during the question period. And when it's your turn to speak, you'll be prompted to unmute yourself by pressing *6. For everyone else, you can use the raise hand function in your Zoom screen. And when it's your turn to speak, you'll get a little notice that it's time to unmute yourself. In the interest of time, we ask that you please keep your questions direct and to the point where possible. And when you're typing in questions, please type in full questions so we know what your topic is about. Instead of asking, what does that mean? Or can you explain more? Please let us know the topic you're asking about. Out of respect for everyone listening in and for the presenters, please be respectful in your tone and the use of the chat and the Q&A functions. Derogatory language or comments towards any individuals will not be tolerated, and anyone using abusive language will be removed from the session. We'll try and answer as many questions as possible tonight, and any questions that we don't get to, we'll aim to address on our website afterwards. So let's get started. I'd now like to welcome Stephen Gluck, Canada's lead negotiator for the Columbia River Treaty, and Kathy Eichenberger, BC's lead on the Canadian negotiation delegation. Take it away, Steve.
Yeah, thank you, Brooke, and good evening, everyone. I'm happy to be here to be able to update you on the AIP. My task tonight is I'm going to highlight how we got to the stage, the key priorities achieved, and the next steps in the process. I will then turn it over to BC and the Canadian Columbia Basin and First Nations colleagues to get into details of what we have agreed to and a good view of what understanding we've reached with the US and how it compares to a treaty continue situation. First, I would like to extend my acknowledgement to the Tanaha, Squamish, and Sioux Okanagan nations who have contributed so much to the process and whose territories are found in the basin. I would also like to recognize the support and input of the people of the basin for your many years of contributions, insight, advice on the range of issues concerning the CRT. This has helped inform the priorities we brought to the table in these negotiations. So, what is the AIP? It is Canada's and the United States' understanding of where we've landed in negotiations in terms of what we would like to see in a modernized treaty. The AIP is a non-legally binding document providing the Canadian and US teams the pathway or a framework to begin drafting amendments for a modernized CRT. We've highlighted in the video and the information document posted on the BC CRT website details of the AIP framework. As we've updated you over the past several years during in-person and virtual town halls and briefing sessions, you know that we have been in negotiations with the US since May 2018. We've held 19 negotiation rounds, other intersessionals, as well as trading multiple proposals. And as you know, and it bears repeating because of the uniqueness of this particular process, the Canadian team was made up of federal, provincial, and First Nations representation. I believe this has made us stronger and better informed during the negotiations. Given the complexity of the issues and looking to ensure that a broader range of elements would be considered and incorporated in a modernized treaty, the negotiations took some time. For the Canadian side, we focus very strongly on increasing flexibility in the operation of the three Canadian dams for domestic priorities, such as for ecosystem improvements and supporting Indigenous cultural values, socioeconomic, as well as community interests. This is something that we heard right from the beginning of the treaty review process in Canada. And knowing the negative impacts faced in the basin over the term of the treaty, we committed to getting this flexibility, which will be explained in more detail in a few minutes. The AIP also includes a new pre-planned flood risk management regime for the U.S. that would replace the current assured regime that just expired yesterday, as a matter of fact, and it contains a similar hydropower operation. This also includes new compensation to Canada for providing these services and added compensation for the additional benefits that the Canadian treaty dams provide to the U.S. for such things as irrigation, navigation, recreation. I should add that all the monetary benefits received stay in the province. While the CRT continues, it can still be terminated by either party with 10 years notice. The new pre-planned flood risk management and the ongoing power coordination are for 20 years. And this puts the updated compensation for FRM and additional compensation, as well as the Canadian entitlement for power coordination, on the same 20-year timeframe. We are also creating a transboundary body that will make recommendations on ecosystem benefits, the integration of Indigenous cultural values, adaptive management, and work together to study salmon reintroduction. We have also agreed to help augment flows for anadromous fish for the US and Canada as part of the modernization. Also, there are commitments to work together on the Kootenai Basin Kookanoosa issues, which will also be explained in detail shortly. So those are the highlights, but just to let you know of a few process questions. Like we're doing today and over the coming months, however mindful of BC election requirements, we, meaning all of us today, will continue to engage with you, the Basin communities, and the Canadian Columbia Basin First Nations on where we're at. This engagement will continue to help inform the modernizing of the treaty. We will also need to turn the understandings that we've reached with the US into treaty texts. This would be in the form of amendments to the current CRT. And while there is interest in both parties to get to a settled agreement, it will take us a bit of time to get there. Along with treaty drafting, there are also approval processes necessary in both countries, as well as in BC. And we are also, as part of this, working towards our commitment to seek free, prior, and informed consent with the Indigenous nations on the modernized CRT. Federally for Canada, treaties require approval by cabinet, and this will be necessary for the CRT. At this point, there are no timelines for this, and we'll need acceptable drafted treaty language before this happens. In the US, they will likely require advice and consent of the Senate as part of their treaty ratification process. As we've previously said, we're going to work hard to get to a final agreement. Until then, we are working with the US on interim measures to ensure collaboration on power coordination, including the delivery of the Canadian entitlement, and to provide pre-planned flood risk management to the US beyond this month. This will also include the payment to Canada. This will enable us to working towards modernizing the treaty and bring it into force while we can continue to coordinate and be compensated. There will also be future public engagement on the Canadian flexibility options, which will be described by the other presenters in a few minutes. I'll repeat, it's important to be clear that there is no set date for when a modernized CRT will come into effect. Both countries have committed to getting it done as soon as possible, but right now we're focusing on engagement. I'll now turn it over to Kathy to get into further details. Thanks very much.
Welcome, Kathy.
Oh, thank you very much. And glad that so many people could attend, people from both sides of the border, and we welcome everyone. My name is Kathy Eichenberger, and I'm the Executive Director of the Columbia River Treaty team in for the government of BC, and I'm also the BC lead negotiator in the modernization of the Columbia River Treaty. So the purpose of this evening session is to be able to connect with you directly to explain what's in the Columbia River Treaty Agreement Principle and to give you a first chance, not your only chance, but your first chance to ask questions. But before we get to that, I'd like to provide a little bit more context on how we got here. The AIP, you know, is really in many ways a product of more than a decade of engagement with a whole host of people. In 2012, the British Columbia provincial government started a process of engaging with First Nations, local governments, and residents of the BC Columbia Basin. Knowing that we might have an opportunity to modernize the treaty, we wanted to find out what people's priorities were, what they would like to see changed, if we would eventually be able to reach a modernized treaty. We wanted to do what the governments didn't do when the original treaty was developed. So in the past 12 years, we've held more than 50 in-person meetings, social media, newsletters, emails. We received many letters and even one-on-one phone calls, which I personally enjoy very much. And so we used every means possible to reach out to people directly, including visiting colleges and schools, and participating in a number of forums on both sides of the border. So at all of those meetings, myself and other members of the Canadian negotiating delegation has taken part to share with you as much as we could during the negotiations and in as direct way as possible. We've worked closely with the Columbia River Treaty Local Governments Committee, and they've been really invaluable as providing the province with advice on how to engage citizens and what the interests of their constituents were. And we also have worked closely with the Columbia Basin Regional Advisory Committee to make sure that the basin's interests were well represented. And so that engagement continues. So we're here virtually with you tonight, but intend to be, as mentioned, later this year, back in person for more face-to-face community meetings, as we've done in the past. But for now, we're in this phase, this next phase of engagement with all of you. So we have an AIP, which we believe reflects as much as possible what people would like to see in a modernized Columbia River Treaty. Is it perfect? Well, from the get-go, we can probably agree that it's not perfect, but that's not really an option when we're negotiating between two countries. What I believe and what we believe that we have today is a modernized treaty that is much better than what we've had for the past six decades. And by the way, yesterday was the 60th anniversary of the Columbia River Treaty. I believe also that it's the best agreement we can get in terms of achieving what we heard from you and what we're aiming for. It's better than the status quo. And we believe it's also better than termination of the treaty, and we'll explain why throughout this evening. I'll get in specifics in a moment, but over the past decade of hearing from all of you from all corners of the basin, we heard over and over again that people felt that the treaty put too much emphasis on power generation and flood risk management, and not enough on environmental and social interests. So today we have an AIP that shifts that balance. As Steve Gluck mentioned, the AIP is a product of 6 years of negotiations with the US, and it's a meeting of the minds between Canada and US to guide the development of the modernized treaty language, which is why we would like your input during this period while the process is underway to influence the drafting of a modernized treaty. But before you give us your feedback, it's important to understand what the AIP is and how it creates significant differences from what the current treaty provides today. Over the past few weeks, since the AIP has been reached, our team's been working hard to provide as much information as possible as we can to the people out there. We've posted initially a backgrounder on our website. We have frequently asked questions, which we keep adding to about the AIP. We also produced a 30-minute video that documents what the AIP's content is. And finally, a written document that goes even more in depth, a 9-pager that describes the elements of the agreement principles. So there's a lot of information out there already, but the AIP is very complex, and there's a lot of technical aspects challenging to those who are not experts in the CRT. So for the purpose of this evening's session, I'd like to focus on what's new in AIP and how it's different than what is in the current treaty. So for any of you who've already gone through the material on our website, this will hopefully provide you with more context for the info and that you've seen already and an opportunity to ask questions. And for those who haven't, this should give you a good overview of the AIP and what you can expect to see in a modernized treaty. So I'll start with flood risk management. So a flood risk management, along with power generation, the coordination of power generation, was one of the prime reasons for the creation of the CRT more than six decades ago. Flood risk management is going to continue under the modernized treaty, but there's going to be a significant change. Under the current treaty, or as of prior to yesterday when the assured flood risk management expired, Canada provided the U.S. with 8.95 million acre feet of pre-planned storage in the Canadian Treaty Reservoir, so namely the Duncan, the Arrow, and the Kinbasket. By the way, a million acre feet is just what it sounds like. It's an acre with a foot deep of water times a million. That storage serves to reduce risk of floods and flood damage, but not just in the United States. It also in BC communities like Trail and Castlegar. But the 16 years of planned FRM has now expired, and it only leaves currently an ad hoc called upon regime. So in the AIP, instead of providing 8.95 million acre feet, Canada will provide 3.6 million acre feet, a 60% reduction from the current level. The 3.6 million acre feet will be stored in Arrow Lakes Reservoir because Arrow Lakes Reservoir provides the most effective storage in terms of minimizing flood risk south of the border. That's still a reduction from the previous FRM, which was 5.1 million acre feet. And it is not providing that amount of flood storage volume every year. It will depend on what kind of forecast there is for floods. It'd be a lesser degrees many a time, up to, but not always, 3.6 million acre feet. And this will also reduce flood risk in Castlegar and Trail. So as Steve mentioned, the U.S. will pay $37.6 million in U.S. indexed to inflation for 20 years. Because this is going to be a reduction, about a 60% reduction in the required amount of flood storage space compared to previously, there will be less FRM restrictions on how BC operates its reservoir. As a result, the United States will have to take this into account and be a bit more conservative in how they operate their own storage and their own reservoirs. And they will continue to be able to call on us for additional storage in cases where there is high flood risk in the United States, but they will have to pay a fee. So that regime is known as called upon flood risk management. They will plan to make effective use of their storage space in their reservoirs before requesting our help. Now, called upon has been part of the treaty for 60 years, but it's never been used, it's never been needed. And so we don't have the same understanding of how and when called upon would be triggered and implemented. But there is a commitment in the agreement principle to develop a process to try and bridge that gap in understanding. In addition to that, for Kootenay Lake, there is a transboundary multi-jurisdictional group calling the Kootenay Transboundary Working Group, that including Canadian Basin First Nations, US tribes, to work together to address the joint interests in the binational Kootenay Basin. So these include environmental, Indigenous, recreational, power and flood risk objectives, and it has a mandate to inform a broad range of interests. Part of it will look at the flood levels in Kootenay Lake, and there's a recognition that that Canada has recognized that at 1752 feet in Kootenay Lake is when the flood damage starts. In the current treaty, Canada can request some changes in operations for Libby Dam when in season, when there appears to be having issues around increased flood risk. But this new Kootenay Transboundary Collaborative Working Group will expand that mandate and have more collaboration on all of the operations on both sides of the border and management practices for the entire Kootenay Basin. So that is the segment on flood risk management.
Thanks, Kathy. I think we can pause for a moment and take some questions. And I will note, we do see some questions coming into us that are not directly related to flood risk management, but we can save for the end of our session when we open it up to more broader questions. So those who have submitted them just know that we've seen them. There also were some folks who emailed us questions ahead of the session. And so I'd like to share one of those, which I think you've already addressed, but just to reiterate the point, the BC government website states that annual storage expires automatically in 2024. Will annual storage be renegotiated?
Yes, absolutely. And as I've mentioned, it is renegotiated from 8.95 million acre feet in all three reservoirs to a maximum of 3.6 million acre feet in storage in Arrow Lakes.
That's great. Thanks, Kathy. And I'd also like to welcome our colleague, Jeff Gossin, who is part of the CRT team, and he's keeping an eye on the Q&As being typed in here. Jeff, do we have a question about flood risk management that we can ask?
Yes, we have a couple. I'll just choose this one. Why is all the flood planned storage in Canada in the Arrow Lakes, and lake levels will be raised even if there is no expected flood risk, and lake use is destroyed by draining the lake by mid-August?
Well, so there are a number of different issues that overlap there. On the flood risk management side, the maximum will now be 3.6 million acre feet, so less than what was provided previously. And it won't be required every year. Why Arrow Lakes? Well, Arrow Lakes Reservoir is the closest to the border. It's the most effective in reducing flood risk as opposed to storage all the way up to Kinbasket. And Duncan has minimal storage there available even previously. So that is the reason why Arrow Lakes is being the source of the flood risk management flood storage.
Thanks, Kathy, and thanks, Jeff. Is there another question about flood risk management, or should we move on to the next portion?
Does the updated flood risk management storage level mean that the water level in the Arrow Lakes will be allowed to be even lower?
And not for flood risk management purposes, no. In fact, for flood risk management purposes only, Arrow had to, at the maximum, provide 5.1 million acre feet, which would lower the elevation much, much further. Now it will only, as a maximum, have to provide 3.6 million acre feet. Now there may be other reasons for having lower Arrow Lakes Reservoir elevations for ecosystems, for example, but it's not related to flood risk management.
Thanks, Kathy. And I think that next portion will be talked about a bit more when we speak about the Canadian flexibility that's been negotiated in the EIP. So great questions. Thanks very much, everybody. Let me just double check the time here. Okay, we have one person who's raised their hand, and I think we can go to that question and then we'll move on to the next section. So Sabine, I'm going to allow you to talk. If you could unmute yourself and you can go ahead and ask your question.
Yes, hello. I have a question regarding the planning, you know, the planning at the end of winter and how we can foresee how the lake levels on Arrow will be through the summer. It's quite often that we are left a little bit in the blank, and then the forecast comes week by week. But once we know how the snowpack was, can we foresee, or can this new treaty foresee the lake levels?
Usually snowpacks start to get measured in March, but it's really early days then to be able to forecast how that amount of snow will melt and at what rate, and that's really what causes the floods. And so as the freshet season starts in April and in May, we get a better idea of what it's going to look like. So it does really take until that time to be able to predict with some certainty what the flood risk is and how to operate the reservoirs for avoiding flooding, both in Canada and Trail in Castlegar, and also in the United States. And so that's why there is usually a biweekly or even sometimes a more frequent predictions on lake levels. Now, that's only one factor in determining reservoir elevations. The other factors are up till today or up till now or until a modernized treaty is in place, coordination for power generation in the US. But now we'll be also talking about changes in reservoir management for ecosystems.
Okay.
Great. Thanks very much, Sabine, and thanks, Kathy. We will now move on to the next part of our presentation. And again, we will have time for questions at the end as well. So thanks, everyone. And a reminder also to make sure your questions go into the Q&A box instead of the chat. So Kathy, why don't you go ahead and move along?
Yes, thank you. I'm going to talk a little bit about, just to introduce a topic on the Canadian flexibility, and then pass it over to my negotiating delegation colleague to continue on. So throughout the engagement process to date, and throughout the whole 6 years of negotiations with the US, we've used the word flexibility a lot. We've spoken it about wanting the flexibility and how BC operates its treaty dams to meet our own objectives, our own domestic objectives. And with the AIP, we've achieved that. The current treaty requires Canada and the US to annually coordinate 15.5 million acre feet of reservoir storage behind the three treaty dams to enhance hydropower generation in the US. Under the modernized treaty, we will be able to unilaterally decide how to reduce that coordinated power storage to meet what we need to see, what we want to mitigate as far as impacts in Canada. We'll be able to reduce it to a minimum from 15.5 million acre feet to 11.5 million acre feet, so up to 4 million acre feet for the first 15 years, and then another million acre feet after that. So it's a third of the reservoir storage in all of the behind the treaty dams to be able to look at what kind of objectives we want to achieve and how to achieve them. It will be water management on our own terms every year to support BC Basin interests without needing agreement with the United States. And we've heard consistently throughout the 12 years of consultation with local governments and basin communities that the environmental values must be considered in the treaty. And one of the ways of addressing this is to focus on this newfound flexibility on ecosystem enhancement and Indigenous cultural values and meeting or trying to achieve objectives for socioeconomic interests, such as recreation and transportation. So with that, I will pass it along to my colleague, Nathan.
Thanks, Kathy. So I'd like to welcome Nathan Matthew, who is the Shwetmik Lake Nation lead on the Canadian negotiating delegation. Nathan, go ahead.
Good evening. Nathan Matthew runs Quest. I'm the one of the senior representatives of the Shwetmik Nation, and we're certainly glad to be part of the negotiations. And the three nations, the Tanakh, Shwetmik, and the Silks Okanagan, we are working to ensure our collective interests are heard with regard within the negotiations and within future operations of the system. And we're particularly interested in our own cultural values, as that include the ecological, environmental values and salmon. And we're particularly attentive to the socioeconomic interests of basin residents. So just to note that the three of our nations, that we've fully participated in negotiating the priorities, objectives, and positions that have been taken by the Canadian delegation. So we've had our voice heard, and we're certainly well underway in terms of having sort of a place in all the negotiations. We've attended all the main table negotiations, including the all of the related strategic planning and debriefing sessions. So we've been fully engaged. Thanks. Next. So flexibility, as Kathy mentioned, is a big thing. We've got about a third of the water that's available has been turned over to the Canadian, BC, First Nations to make our own decisions about how we want to use that water. And that's new. It did not happen before. So the operating decisions before were the Canada-US entities, and now it's going to be unilateral, made in BC decisions. And what we are calling sort of the use of that water is a specified operation. So we're going to operate in a specific way or ways in order to achieve those ecological, socioeconomic, cultural values. So the decisions are going to be made from the provincial, Indigenous, federal, local government, and ENGO scientific and technical representatives. So we'll have a quite a comprehensive sort of group that will be talking about how the whole system will work. And certainly that's a development of the specified operations, the amount of volume that is stored and flow. Using the volume that we choose would sort of really be beneficial to our size. And the governance in terms of oversight, and now it's the entities, and in the future it's going to be the BC, Silks, Tanakh, Shwetmik Nations, as well as input from local governments and public from the basin. So big changes, and it's been a long road to get to this point. Next. So there's been a lot of work. We've been studying and modeling, developing, evaluating the hydro system operations since 2019. So we've been looking at how we can change the storage and flows to achieve sort of additional benefits. And we've held public sessions in these areas, ecosystem and socioeconomic goals, objectives and performance measures. So we've been talking about that with the public for a couple of years now. And the modeling is pretty interesting. We're taking a look at that 0 to 4 million acre feet range. And we're looking at sort of the impact of 1 million acre feet for this, 2 million acre feet for that, and doing that assessment. And of course, we're committed to local government public consultation prior to decision making. So we'll be seeking feedback on the specifics. And it's still underway in terms of the studying and the modeling and looking at the different scenarios. And when a decision is made, we'll be putting it out there for comment. Thanks. So again, we're doing the studying and looking at changes in operations. And we're certainly looking at the rejuvenation of wetlands, riparian and floodplain areas, and ways to increase support for salmon and other fish species. Also looking at the improvement of socioeconomic values, flooding, navigation, recreation, those kind of things that are of concern to the basin residents. And a big question is climate change. And so there's been some consideration of how to address that through adaptive management into the future. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Nathan. Well, so we'll pause again just to see if there's any questions about the Canadian flexibility portion of the AIP or what Kathy and Nathan have spoken to. And we did receive a question in advance that I'd like to share, and then we'll go to the questions you have been asking in the Q&A box. So this question is, how does the domestic flexibility of 4 to 5 million acre feet, how will it be used? There's a lot of fear that BC Hydro will not be enthusiastic to use this volume for non-power uses, as has been demonstrated over the years. There needs to be an outline and hard constraints for this domestic flexibility for ecosystem use. When may the public see the modeling that has been ongoing for this flexibility?
Well, I think I mentioned that the intent is to take up to 4 million acre feet and use it outside of hydroelectric power generation specifically. Now, that's not to say that through the flows that we're using for ecological, cultural values or social economic purposes, that BC Hydro can't use those flows when it's appropriate for them to do that, because the water is going to be going through the dams. So that's a commitment. And certainly as Indigenous representatives, we're committed to ensuring that the purposes that were set out and the plans for the use of the SO are carried through. And I think the province has the same level of commitment.
Yes, and I could add, if I can, Nathan, is it the work is underway and people are impatient to know, okay, what is it going to look like on the ground? How is it going to change things in my area? And we know that people are anxious to see that. The modeling is still, I would say another good 6 months away, if not a little bit more, because it's very complex and it's a very wide basin, and trying to look at how to enhance all these different values is, it takes time to try and get it right. And so, but one thing that we will do is to go out again and go to communities and say, this is what it looks like. What is your feedback? We have done some of that already. We had a virtual session on the performance measures for ecosystem function, and that's on our website as well. And we could provide a link to that. And also the CRT local governments committee have been championing the objective, socioeconomic objectives, and have had public meetings on performance measures for that as well. So they are really pushing hard on those objectives and seeing we can try and amalgamate or try and address some of the impacts at the same time as or in addition to the very important ecosystem improvements and addressing indigenous cultural values. So when the modeling will be in further developed, we will be coming back to the basin and you will have a full picture of what this might look like before it gets implemented or decisions made. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Kathy and Nathan. So I don't see any questions directly related to flexibility. Again, lots of questions about reservoir levels, et cetera, but let's save that to the end and move through the next different components of the AIP. So if I could actually invite Kathy back to talk about the power and transmission components.
Great, thank you. So one of the important aspects in the past in present, but also in the future, is coordination for power. So the Canadian and U.S. entities, that is BC Hydro in Canada and Bonneville Power Administration and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, they conduct joint operational studies to regulate treaty reservoirs. They come to an agreement on how they'll be operated to enhance power generation in the U.S. And in return, BC receives what's called the Canadian entitlement, which is half of the additional hydroelectric power potential that could be produced in the US as a result of how BC operates the treaties. So we get this power from the US in the form of electricity, and that electricity is sold in the market or sold at market value to either BC Hydro, because BC Hydro also purchases that power, that Canadian entitlement power from the province, or it's sold on the US market. Revenue from selling the power, as I said, it will continue to go to the province, but a portion of it is also shared with the Tsekwepem Tanakha and Siksika Ogaden nations. So currently the volume for power coordination is 15.5 million acre feet, which is the total Columbia River Treaty storage. In the AIP, it also considers that total volume minus what will be used for the specified operation that we just talked about, the flexibility that we use to meet domestic objectives. But it will also incorporate the FRM rules for flood prevention. The important thing to know also with the specified operation, so the flexibility, is once that's decided, once there's agreement here in BC on what that would look like, that gets incorporated into the treaty operations and they have to be implemented. So that will be a requirement of the treaties to take what we want to do to meet domestic objectives through our flexibility and join it with the power operations. And that is what's going to be, that's going to be implemented through the treaty. So on the Canadian entitlement, currently, if everything is left alone, the Canadian entitlement would be declining. What we've negotiated is a reduction in capacity and energy. So you see on the slide, starting off with 660 megawatts of capacity going down to 305 megawatts by year 20. And for the energy, 550 average megawatts of energy going down to 225, minus a 6.5% per million acre feet of specified operation. Why? Because removing that portion of power coordination removes the benefit of the coordination to the United States, which they therefore don't pay for. So that is a negotiated amount. And I know we've had questions on why it has been reduced to that extent. As I mentioned, the Canadian entitlement, the volume was determined under these formulas that are enshrined in the current treaty. It's a three-step, very complex framework to determine the defined downstream power benefits. And it's the half share of the increased power generation potential of the US system, as I said, with and without Canadian storage. So that's how it was set up initially in the 60s. The impact or the benefit of Canadian storage has always been forecast to go down over time. Why? Because the importance and the contribution of the Canadian, the Columbia River Treaty power coordination diminishes when the demand grows and when the U.S. Adds other renewables or other sources of energy in the system. And so that proportionally is much lower than it is today. And so this is reduction is less at the beginning than what we would have anticipated, but it's higher towards the tail end, and it gives us certainty over the next 20 years. So we believe it's a good compromise for both BC and the United States, and it's something that we can assume, you know, will continue for the 20 years. The planning for power coordination is 4 years in advance. It used to be 6 years, so we've shortened that. And again, the timelines for the period for the agreement is 20 years. Yeah, and one more thing is without, you know, based on the formula that is in the treaty, the Canadian entitlement could decline or could have declined to zero by the end of the 2020s or persist over a longer term at a lower level. So that's where we think that it is the certainty is worth the decrease that we've agreed to with the United States. The next slide is on transmission. Another component of the agreement principle that may not be felt by residents or based in, you know, communities is the ability to secure access to transmission north to south to north on the intertie that is on the west side of the province going into the United States. And that access to transmission would have declined proportional to the decline of the Canadian entitlement. But that access transmission is important to BC, as it allows BC Hydro to buy power when it's economically advantageous to do so, and keeps our high producing reservoirs at a higher level, such as Kinbasket, for example, so that there is a higher storage for electricity production during cold months in the winter time. So the achievement of 1120 megawatts of transmission is important to sustain, you know, energy security and reliability for the system. There are also a potential new transmission that may come to be in the eastern side of the province. That will depend on whether Bonneville Power Administration, which is basically the federal equivalent of the BC Hydro in the Pacific Northwest, will study the expanded transmission between BC and the US, and which is near Nelway, which east of Trail down to Spokane, and Bonneville Power Administration may decide to expand its transmission facilities there to enable more clean energy trade between Canada and US, which would provide economic reliability and environmental benefits on both sides of the border, and include support to continue to add renewable energy in both countries. And finally, I'd just like to talk about the additional compensation that we've negotiated. We've talked about the Canadian entitlement and the new flood risk management payments that we'll be getting from the US, but there is additional compensation that we've negotiated in the agreement in principle. We have in the past talked a lot about other downstream benefits, and these refer to what we believe are many additional benefits that the US enjoys from the operation of the Canadian treaty reservoirs that was primarily for power and flood control, but also benefit the US for irrigation and recreation, navigation, fisheries. And so these benefits come as a result of our operations here, but they've never really been accounted for in the past. So through this negotiation process, the US has recognized these additional benefits and will provide an additional $16.6 million US indexed to inflation once the modernized treaty is in place. And again, because of the 1963 agreement, the benefits will be coming and flowing to the province of BC. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Kathy. I think we can pause for a couple of questions here and then move into the next portion. But I'll turn it over to Jeff. Jeff, do we have a question that we can ask either related to power and transmission, or I see there's a few more about the Canadian flexibility as well.
There aren't specific questions about power and coordination, but somebody asked a question just as we were completing the flexibility segment which he asks, will this flexibility help reduce the rapid and extreme loss of water during late summer and fall?
That is one of the things that we are looking at, and that's relating to the power coordination. Recall that we may choose to use up to 4 million acre feet from the 15.5 million acre feet and operate differently for riparian and floodplain and wetlands, but also looking at maintaining or looking at a minimum elevation in Arrow Lakes, for example. I know a lot of people here tonight are from the Arrow Lakes. And yes, that is an instrument that may address minimum Arrow Lakes elevation.
And there's another question. Will there be any additional constraints imposed on BC Hydro's management of storage in Kinbasket to address the ecological and social recreational effects on Arrow?
Again, yes, depending on how the new flexibility that we've repatriated, if we could call it that, a third of what the power coordination volume was, can be applied in Arrow, it could be applied in Kinbasket, can be applied in Duncan. So the modeling that's being done to look at improvements in those three reservoirs and for flows for fish are looking at all of three reservoirs in a kind of a system-wide kind of a lens, and that will also be, you know, presented to people in all the communities in the basin once that's further developed.
Great. Thanks very much, Kathy and Jeff. So we'll move along to hear more about the ecosystem components in the AIP. I'd like to welcome Jamie Vienno from the Tanaha Nation. Jamie is the Tanaha Nation representative on the Canadian negotiating delegation. Welcome, Jamie.
Thank you very much, Brooke. Thank you, Val. Kiso kiukit, everyone. As Brooke mentioned, I'm Jamie Vienno, and I represent the Tanaha Nation at the Canadian delegation in treaty negotiations. And tonight, I'll be speaking about these two new bodies, which represent a major accomplishment in the negotiations for the inclusion of ecosystems and Indigenous cultural values in a modernized treaty. Both of these bodies are still under development with a lot of details still to be worked out. Under the current treaty, there is a limited input to the operations of the Libby Dam. However, under the AIP, this new body, the Kootenai Transboundary Collective Working Group, will provide a forum for more collaboration and cooperation between US and Canada on Libby Dam operations, and a greater range of interests will be considered. I will provide a few more details shortly. The Joint Ecosystem and Indigenous Cultural Values Body, also known as the JEB, is a brand new body under the AIP, which does not exist under our current treaty. It will take a one river approach, and I will provide a few more details. For example, it's a formal recommendations to enhance ecosystem health across the Columbia River in Canada and into the United States. It's led by Canadian Indigenous Nations and US tribes and includes an adaptive management program. So then I'll move on to the Kootenai Transboundary Collective Working Group and explain a bit more of that. And it's an expanded tri-national working group that will provide recommendations to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers on various variations to Libby Dam operations that affect both upstream and downstream of Libby Dam in the Kootenai Basin. It's intended to include direct participation from the Indigenous nations and the tribes. It evaluates approaches to addressing Indigenous values, ecosystem needs, flood risk management, recreation, socioeconomic, and hydropower operations within both countries. Make recommendations responsive to the interests just described in the last bullet is relative to the Kootenai Basin operations in Canada and the United States, including Kookanoosa Reservoir downstream to Kootenai Lake. We'll also develop a binational mechanism to review decisions made by operating entities when these decisions differ from the KT CW recommendations, which is again the Kootenai Transboundary Collaborative Working Group. Speaking a bit more about the JEB and what does that mean, the Joint Ecosystem and Indigenous Cultural Values Body, it looks as a new body under the Columbia River Treaty, and it will give Indigenous nations and tribes a voice in decision-making. It will make formal recommendations on how treaty and other non-treaty hydro system operations may be changed to better support ecosystem needs and Indigenous and tribal cultural values. A one river approach reflects the sacred duty to improve ecosystem health for all living things from the Columbia River headwaters all the way to the estuary at the Pacific Ocean. I mentioned the one river approach earlier, from which the Indigenous nations perspective reflects the sacred duty. The Joint Ecosystem and Indigenous Cultural Values Board is also unique in that it will be led and co-chaired by Indigenous nations and tribes. Equal representation from Indigenous nations and tribes and between the United States and Canada, which includes BC. Collaboration with the KTCW and interaction with the the additional stakeholders and transboundary groups as needed. Collaboration with the Kootenai Transboundary Collaborative Working Group, we want to make sure recommendations from these two bodies on the different basins are aligned when they need to be and to be complementary. The interaction with the additional stakeholders and transboundary groups is needed. This engagement with community is envisioned and detailed on how we are still going to be working those details out. Recommendations are expected to be made by consensus of all of its Indigenous nations and tribal representatives. Canadian and U.S. representatives will participate in JEB discussions and work plan development. Recommendations will be provided to the parties and the entities and agencies of the province or state to inform their decision-making operations. And JEB recommendations will be made available to public, so there'll be transparency in what changes and operations may be proposed. So what happens with those recommendations? Well, recommendations from the JEB will either be implemented or the parties or entities will need to explain why they won't be implemented in whole or in part. A key component of the JEB work plan will include an adaptive management program. It will be important to monitor and make changes in operations when needed to respond to future climate change. An adaptive management program will use both Western science and Indigenous tribal knowledge to develop its work plan, which includes setting objectives, monitoring and performance measures to determine if changes are needed and anticipated benefits are being achieved. Changes that are identified by the adaptive management program will be used to trigger recommendations by the JEB. And we are mindful of the need to be efficient and that this is not intended to duplicate existing monitoring programs that are in the Columbia Basin, but rather utilize existing information to identify gaps. In addition to the adaptive management, the JEB will also provide a forum for transboundary coordination and cooperation on salmon reintroduction and fish flow augmentation operations. And I will now turn it over to my colleague, Jay Johnson, to speak more in detail of salmon reintroduction and the fish flow augmentation.
Thanks very much, Jamie. And before we move it over to Jay, I would like to take a pause for questions. There's certainly some questions coming in after these past couple of components. So I think what we'll do is go to Jeff first and see if there is a written question that we can ask. And I do see there's a couple of hands raised as well. And then we'll go over to Jay. So Jeff, what question do you have for us?
All right. So yes, we have a couple of questions about the Kootenai Transboundary Collaborative Work Group. Will there be any coordination between the KTCW and the International Joint Commission's Kootenai Lake Board of Control?
Would one of the panelists like to take that question on? Feel free to turn your camera on and unmute. Go ahead, Kathy.
Sure. Yes, there absolutely will be, and there will have to be, because it is one system. The Kootenai is part of the Columbia system. And operations and changes to the Kootenai will affect the Columbia as it joins in Castlegar. But even more than that, the objectives, especially including the ecosystem and Indigenous cultural value objectives, that the joint ecosystem body are looking at through the headwaters all the way to the mouth, also include the Kootenai system. And so there's going to be some real good interaction and collaboration between the two. Obviously not working at cross purposes, but there'll be synergies even more with the two working together. And for those who are wondering, well, who's going to be part of these bodies, and for example, the Kootenai Transboundary Collaborative Work Group, the terms of reference haven't been established yet, but it's meant to be multi-party and with agencies, federal, provincial, Canadian First Nations, U.S. tribes, and local government involvement as well. So this is at the early stages of both those committees, the Kootenai Transboundary Collaborative Working Group and the Joint Ecosystem Body, where that this development work is just starting.
Thanks very much, Kathy. So there is somebody who has their hand raised, and I'm going to allow you to speak. If you've just received a notice to unmute yourself, please go ahead and ask your question. And we'll give it a moment here. Sometimes there's technical difficulties with that, allowing people to unmute themselves. All right. I'm sorry that that's not working out. That is okay. If you want to enter your question into the Q&A, we'll be sure to address it there. Jeff, do we have one more question that we can ask from the Q&As?
Yes. It starts with a statement. The KTWC and JEB groups are positive additions. However, will there be any changes to the membership and structure of the actual treaty entities? Under the current treaty, the Canadian entity only includes BC Hydro.
Thanks, Jeff. Would one of our presenters like to take that on? Maybe Kathy again or Stephen.
Yes, I will, if I can get my Zoom screen back on. Yes, I mean, the composition of the Permanent Engineering Board and the entities are at the discretion of the countries. And there has always been the opportunity to amend and change that. We are in very deep conversations with the Secwepemc, Tanakh, and Siksik Okanagan on governance issues, initially on the decisions around the specified operations for implementing flexibility in Canada, but that has also been brought up for sure. So it'll be part of ongoing discussions.
Great. Thanks very much, Kathy, and thanks for those who asked those good questions. We'll move along to our last portion of the presentations before opening it up to more questions. I'd now like to welcome Jay Johnson, who is the Sioux Okanagan representative on the negotiating delegation. Welcome, Jay.
Well, hi, Haskell Health, Chaisin Squeeze. My name is Jay Johnson. I'm the chief negotiator and advisor to the Chief Executive Council of the Sioux Okanagan Nation, and it's been an honor and a privilege to be part of and lead the negotiation engagement on behalf of the Sioux Okanagan Nation for the Columbia River Treaty. And what you've heard so far is that really getting a snapshot into the kinds of changes that we've been able to successfully secure as part of the international negotiations with the United States, Canada, British Columbia, and First Nations of Canada and tribal groups in the United States. And what you've begun to see is how we've worked to do our best, given that the realization that we have concrete in the river and a multitude of significant dams throughout the whole Columbia system that we're inserting and trying to reimagine the river as a river, the river it is itself, and an ecosystem itself, and secure that that knowledge and monitor it and enhance it. So what I wanted to talk about a little bit today was, in addition to creating the flexibility through the specified operations that you've heard, securing a significant volume of water for the management within Canada on the Canadian side for ecosystem, cultural value purposes, and socioeconomic interests, something that was not in the original treaty, so something that's quite significant. And also with the addition of adding the Joint Ecosystem Cultural Values Body, which is a north-south U.S.-Canada process that will monitor the operations for environmental interests and cultural values, that will be able to make pretty significant recommendations as needed to operations and implementation of the treaty on an ongoing basis, something that didn't exist prior to now. We're also talking today about anadromous fish and the central importance of salmon and the commitments that both governments and all participants and basin residents and so forth have been demanding for years. And as a former basin resident and someone who grew up in the basin, I know how important the Columbia River Treaty is to people, and I know how critically important and how hard it has been to live through the loss of the salmon for all those years and beyond my years too, even. And so what we've done is secure the 1 million acre feet, which is an annual amount for flow for anadromous fish migration, both north-south. And what's new into the treaty is that commitment, of course, is for the duration, the 20-year period in it, as an annual basis. But we've added an additional 0.5 million acre feet for low water years to support those salmon populations in Canada and the United States. And so that's to ensure that there's flows both north and south. And then the other part of that is that salmon reintroduction is critical, and it is seen as being very, very important to both countries, and that we deepen the collaboration, not just through the JB, but also through joint work, both through tribal groups and First Nations, but also through mainstream channels with governments and entities and programming and studies and so forth. So go to the next slide, please. So an anadromous fish flow augmentation is otherwise known as FFA. We seem to really like acronyms, and you'll get a lot of them. So I know that there's glossaries out there that will help us all, including ourselves, keep on top of the acronyms. The fish flow augmentation, it like I said, it represents that dedicated volume of water for spring and summer flows for migrating anadromous fish in the United States and Canada. We secured, as I mentioned, the commitment of 1 million acre feet, and we add that extra 0.5 for dry water years. And that will be determined through forecasting that in the spring at the Dalles in Oregon. So we'll have an insight into that on an annual basis. Canada will, of course, ensure that the million acre feet of storage is there by mid-April and release the water between May 1st and August 7th. That's a little bit of a longer window than the previous time that allows for summer migrations. And as we know, the salmon can have micro migrations within this seasonal cycle. So we're able to try to capture as much as we can there. And both the US and Canada will report on this activity to the JEB on both the use and the value of this fish flow augmentation. And then the JEB will assess on an ongoing basis the effectiveness and also seek improvements and make recommendations on an ongoing basis about those improvements as we learn more and monitor the effectiveness and also consider climate change. Next slide. Salmon reintroduction. This is so critically important, not just to all First Nations in the basin and beyond, and all tribal groups along the river system down to the estuary in the Pacific Ocean, but to communities, to residents, to many groups. And we're just pleased that we were able to have serious conversations about salmon reintroduction within the Columbia River Treaty negotiations and recognize the importance of the river. The river was once the source of the largest salmon runs in the world. It included all salmon species, and for some historical anomaly and really a byproduct of the times in the 60s, it was ignored completely in the treaty. And the river was seen as a resource and rather than an ecosystem. So we're doing our best to change that and recognize that salmon are vital to the ecosystem. They're a key stone species to all Indigenous nations on both sides of the border. And the Sioux Okanagan, the Shwetmik and Tanakha nations, and the U.S. tribes do have a long history prior to this contemporary negotiations of a new treaty for working to restore critical salmon runs in the upper Columbia and along the river system. And that work has occurred through a variety of activities, including restoring habitat, opening up passage on the Columbia River system, and also collaborating on studies and additional in-stream work. The IIP commitment will help to ensure this institutional support and respect for salmon reintroduction and salmon recovery. Next slide. And we do recognize that both governments have independently supported reintroduction in various ways, and that work has been done through salmon behavioral studies, through fish passage and survival work and studies. But under the IIP, we're now committed to a deeper transboundary collaboration, and that's going to produce results. We're going to be sharing in a more detailed way data and studies and approaches, and those results will have that common goal of reintroducing salmon up into the blocked areas of the upper basin. We know that there is wonderful habitat on the Canadian side in the upper Columbia, and being able to get passage through the remaining facilities and support the technical work that needs to be done. We're looking at the potential for massive runs. I'm not sure how many of you know, but it appears that the Columbia River salmon runs this year will exceed, for the first time in a long time, the salmon runs in the Fraser River. So this reintroduction work from near annihilation of the salmon to these historic numbers of upwards to 500,000 this year are pretty significant and will have the potential to just grow. And all of this work will be monitored by the JEB, the Joint Ecosystem Body that we talked about. Inherent in that is adaptive management, as we've heard. And that collaboration and that monitoring will produce the outcomes of more recommendations and potential for long-term programming. Next slide. So where are we? Next steps. We know the IIP is not the final treaty. This is a historical juncture that sets the progressive terms for modern ice treaty. There's lots of work to do. It considers the needs of the river as an ecosystem. It preserves the flood control and the power requirements, still creates the needed flexibility and begins the process of giving us a chance to start to account for and address climate change curveballs. But we have a ton of work to do, both with the U.S. and on the Canadian side of the border. We need to, in order to put our common intentions into specific details into a written agreement. And you've heard, the need to take the agreement in principle, which is, several pages long, and to turn it into a document that spells out in specific details what we're going to be doing and how we're going to be doing it and how that the treaty will be implemented in more of a specific way. And that's going to take some time. And Indigenous nations ourselves, we have quite a bit of work to do with moving our domestic tables forward with Canada and British Columbia. This is necessary to pave the pathway towards United Nations Declarations of the Rights of Indigenous People and the consent-based regimes that we've built into the process, and that's free, prior, and informed consent. And in order to get there, we're going to be completing our discussions on redress, which is about impacts and mitigation for activities and historical impacts, and benefit sharing, as well as governance. How do our communities have a bigger say into governance and decision-making, and some of those questions were already asked today. So I think that concludes it for me and Lim Limpt, and look forward to conversations and ongoing engagement and moving the work forward. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Jay. And he's right, that concludes the presentations. And now we can open it up to questions. I also note we are at 18 minutes past the hour, and I wanted to let folks know the presenters are all on board to stay longer to answer as many questions as we can. So we don't have a hard stop at the half hour mark here. We'll stay as long as we can for up to 30 minutes to answer other questions. So there's a few questions related to salmon that I'd like to get to first. One was actually sent to us in advance, so I'll read it out. Will all dams on both sides of the border be equipped with fish ladders to assist spawning salmon to finally return to the Upper Columbia and its tributaries? I'm wondering which of our presenters would like to answer that question.
Yeah, the question was about whether there are fish ladders on in, or whether there will be fish ladders, or the treaty requires that. The short answer is no, the treaty doesn't require fish ladders yet. But the good news is that there is passage, fish passage in all the facilities leading up to to Chief Joe and Grand Coulee Dam. And those two facilities have blocked salmon in there. They're just on the other side of the tributary going north, which is the Okanagan River system. And so in that part of the territory, the Silk Okanagan Nation has worked for many years restoring the habitat and creating the conditions necessary for salmon to spawn and be successful in the river system. We're looking at bringing salmon even farther north into the Okanagan Lake, which is, way more habitat for salmon and the potential for even more salmon returning. And in 2000, there were approximately 1,200 sockeye returning to McIntyre Dam, which is, just inside of the Canadian border. And it was a smaller dam, but it was one that was built for irrigation purposes. And most of the Okanagan has been redesigned, the river system has been redesigned and channelized for irrigation purposes. And so we've had to reintroduce the oxbows, which are the bends in the river with gravel channels. And we've used traditional ecological knowledge and the insights of elders on specifically how to do that, what species of plants need to be in the riparian zones around it, and how the river rocks have to be formulated so that salmon can continue to be successful. So we've gone from that to various fluctuations in the river, got passage in McIntyre Dam, got to fish up into Soyuz and beyond. and Escaja, and we've had runs in the hundreds of thousands now in a short period of time, and that success is really spurring us on to do the same work in the eastern part of the territory and in the upper Columbia in collaboration. And collaboration is the key to moving this work forward. So the good news is the U.S. administration, the Biden administration and the White House has put significant resources into studying passage in a detailed way with Northwest residents and entities and specialists, including the tribes, and particularly UCUT, the United Upper Columbia United Tribes Group, which is focused on fishery and ecological enhancements. And they put $225 million U.S. into doing that over the next 20 years. And it looks promising. It looks like already there are some technical ways to get around these last two big dams to get salmon up in the Upper Columbia. And so we remain hopeful. We're going to be doing our best to support that work when and how we can, and hope to see salmon come up in our lifetimes.
Thanks very much, Jay. So Jeff, I think there's another question related to salmon in the Q&A box.
Yes, that's right. Are the kokanee fish included in the CRT definition of salmon?
Go ahead, Kathy.
Well, so the CRT doesn't define salmon or kokanee. I mean, kokanee are of course landlocked salmon, and there's different management objectives for kokanee. So this is the flow augmentation for downstream in the US and in Canada for the very successful Okanagan sockeye rehabilitation program are for anadromous fish. To let people know that this year is a record year for Okanagan sockeye coming back to the system, to Canada. So we know it can be done. It is going to be managed differently.
Great. Thanks very much, Kathy. So I think go ahead, Jay.
Yeah, I was just looking at the chat quickly and saw that the question about salmon and passage was also a question, not just for the U.S. passage to get into Canada, but also Canadian passage to Canadian dams. And that is a separate and more complicated, because we don't have fish ladders. We don't have passage yet. The nations have been working really, really hard to get passage in those Canadian facilities. And we've got commitments to do that and to explore that and to have that occur in Hugh Keenly side. We haven't secured a formal agreement yet with Hydro on Revelstoke, but we do have one on Mica, and we're really pleased with that. Took a long time to get there. And it's when we get this enough volume of the salmon up into butting their heads on those dams, and then passage will occur, or the likelihood that they will be there in the near future, and then they can prepare for that. So still lots of work to do. Lots of work to do to get Canadian passage. They were built a little bit cheaper because they didn't have to have passage. It wasn't a requirement. So they have to do it. We got to get them up there. Thanks.
Thanks, Jay. So let's go back over to one more question that was posed in the Q&As, and then I see someone has their hand raised, so we'll ask that question as well. Go ahead, Jeff.
So there's two questions in this. Will there be a priority for returning Chinook to the Upper Columbia in Canada above the Grand Coulee Dam? And what other species will be prioritized, such as naturally occurring species like lamprey and sturgeon and steelhead?
Who would like to answer that, or is it possible to answer that?
Yeah, I mean, I'll ask others to jump in here, but I could say that the treaty itself doesn't oblige, you know, us to do specific works on any species or put one species in front of the other. But what we've done is done our best, at least from the Indigenous perspective, to bring that need and that criterion, a recognition of the kind of damage that has been done from industrializing the river into a reservoir and blocking passage and creating havoc for the ecosystem. And so there are all kinds of programs, both on the US side and on the Canadian side, that are addressing sturgeon and lamprey and steelhead and Chinook and sockeye, et cetera. And those are going to continue. There's one of the outcomes on the side of this is the development of the Columbia River Salmon Recovery Initiative, Cursory, on the Canadian side, which is its mandate is focused. And some of you on the call are members of Cursory, and we'll recognize the importance of that organization working with the three nations and others, and bringing the salmon back up into the Upper Columbia, and that would be all species. Yeah, thanks.
Thanks very much, Jay. So again, we're happy to continue on. Lots of questions here. I will. I now ask the person whose hand is raised to ask their question verbally. If you're able to unmute yourself, please go ahead and ask your question.
I would like to thank Kathy for her hard work. Thank you, Kathy. You should be getting the medal from the BC government. Anyway, my question to Salmon. The Grand Coulee Dam and Chief Joseph Dams prevented salmon to coming up into the Kootenai River. Until they can prove that salmon can return to the ocean after 4 years and back again, why are we spending money on that study? It's an American problem. They should be spending the money, not Canada. Thank you.
Thanks, Mario. Would somebody like to respond to Mario's comment? Go ahead, Jay.
I'm happy to. I mean, Kathy might want to say something too, but Canada and British Columbia First Nations, the resident basin residents, no one is spending any Canadian dollars on passage. You're absolutely right, Ken. That was a U.S. problem that wreaked absolutely havoc in Canada as a result of blocking precious and sacred salmon from getting up into their spawning grounds, and that's happened since the construction of those dams in the late 30s and early 40s, prior to the CRT. We know that salmon can get and survive from Canada to the Columbia and back with the dams that are the 18 dams that are in the main stem of the Columbia. Because we've got an historic run of almost 500,000 coming back of the sockeye coming back this year into Canada and feeding people all the way along the river. So we're really encouraged by that, and we're using that as our incentive, our motivation to continue the hard work to bring them up into the Upper Columbia main stem. But that $225 million I referred to, those are U.S. dollars from the U.S. White House spending money in the United States to investigate passage opportunities and doing all that study work to make sure that they can get over those last two dams. So you're absolutely right. I just want to assure you, from my perspective, not being a government person, I'm not aware of any Canadian dollars are being spent on that specific issue. So, but we're eager for the results. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Jay. So let's move on to some of the other questions. Jeff, I'm going to turn it over to you to maybe ask a question on a different topic. Go ahead.
Sure. This is about Arrow Lakes. Will the maximum water level of Arrow Lakes stay the same with these negotiations? Also, are you going to be significantly raising the minimum levels as well as having much more control of how fast the lake is drafted?
I would like to answer that one. That's a really good question, Jesse. Thanks for that. When we are looking at improving the environment in Arrow Lakes or in Kinbasket or in Duncan, part of that is to have conditions, reservoir conditions, that will allow riparian ecosystems to be recruited, to be reestablished in the drawdown zone. How far down depends on how many MAF we're going to reduce the maximum elevation. One MAF in Arrow is 8 feet, for example. So that is something that's being modeled to have a maximum elevation to allow for trees and shrubs and other vegetation that is important to all wildlife to be reestablished. Now, that riparian vegetation can withstand flooding 7 out of 8 years. And we have ecologists that are part of the modeling team, the research team that is looking into that. By the way, we have members from the Upper Columbia Basin Environmental Collaborative, which is an association of a collective of a number of environmental non-government organizations who are also working with us and with Indigenous nations or Canadian First Nations in the Canadian Basin to look at exactly those questions. With regards to a minimum elevation, you know, we know and we've seen that some of the elevations during drought years have been not only not favorable for recreation, but also has had impacts on ecosystems. So we're also looking at that as well. And with regards to the drafting, the rapid drafting, the ramping rates is also being researched and added to the modeling to look at how to minimize fish stranding, but also to minimize fish entrainment through the dams. So all of those things are being modeled currently, when we're looking forward to sharing all of that with you all when it's further advanced. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Kathy. Jeff, another question.
Yes, this is relating to Kukanoosa. In the past, it was my understanding that Kukanoosa was not a significant consideration in the treaty. The rise and fall of the water was drastic and obviously harmful to the ecosystem, lifestyles, and irrigation. What sort of considerations have been made to provide a reasonable annual minimum pool level to this lake for future years?
Well, I can start answering that, and maybe Jamie, you'll want to jump in. The purpose of establishing the Kootenai Transboundary Collaborative Working Group is to look at holistically all of the impacts and how to reduce impacts and work together to collaborate to improve conditions upstream of Libby Dam, including Kukanoosa, downstream through the Kootenai River and for sturgeon and bull trout and for recreation and irrigation. So this is why we're quite excited about this Kootenai Transboundary Working Group, because we'll be able to tackle all of that with a really close and good collaboration with our partners in the US. And we've had some discussions during the negotiating period, which were very, very promising. So stay tuned, I would say. And we will be able to share more on once we have the terms of reference and a work plan to look at the management of the Kootenai system. The one thing, though, that people also should realize is that the storage in the Kukanoosa Reservoir also reduces flood risk in Kootenai Lake. So, you know, some folks who believe it should stay at a high level year round would basically in a number of years flood out Kootenai Lake and the communities, you know, downstream of that. And there was talk at one point by some citizens mobilizing to build a weir along the border. That is not under consideration, but we would try to find, we will, with our collaborators, our partners in the US, a balance to try and look at all of these objectives, including power generation and recreation.
Thanks very much, Kathy. Jamie, would you like to add anything to that?
Oh, I just want to thank Kathy for that. And I just wanted to add that, just to note that these are two brand new bodies that we are building as we go. And I'm really excited about the opportunities that these two collaborative tables will develop. So just thank you again, Kathy, and stay tuned, as Kathy's mentioned.
Wonderful. Thanks to both of you. I see somebody has their hand raised, so I'm going to ask them to unmute themselves again.
I can.
Or Mario.
Mario.
Anyway, I'd like to talk about Libby Dam, Kootenai, and Columbia. In the past treaty, we had the right to transfer water from the Kootenai to the Columbia. If we did that, we wouldn't have a problem at Nelson or Kootenai Lake. We would control the level. We could put it in the Columbia. I have some concern that we haven't addressed the dollars. In 2017, the Libby Dam produced $138 million worth of power. None of that was shared with Northern Idaho or Northern Montana, pardon me, and BC. Have we done anything to get share of that power? The other thing I would like to say is that we really need a third neutral power party to settle disputes, because I can see hundreds of them in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mario. And for those who don't know, Mario is a very valued, I think I could call you a senior citizen who's been passionate about the Columbia River Treaty, has been providing advice to BC and Canada for decades. So really appreciate him. On the diversion of the Kootenai into the Columbia, there is a provision in the treaty that allows us to do that. However, that would have major environmental consequences. And today it would not be allowed. It's still in the treaty though. With regards to the power generation, Libby, as it operates for power, also provides flow shaping for power in BC. The Kootenai Canal, BC Hydro Kootenai Canal, would not have been built without Libby power shaping. And so it allows power to be produced also in BC. So that is a benefit for power in BC as well.
Thanks very much for the question and the answer, Kathy. I did see a quick question asking if this session was going to be recorded and posted publicly. Yes, and yes, it will be available on our website after, as well as YouTube, and we'll send a link around to everyone who's registered for this session, letting you know when it's available. We'll also share it via social media. Jeff, do we have another question?
We do. One second, please.
Sure.
Why does the AIP use 2024 as the typical year as a benchmark for reducing the Canadian entitlement? 2024 flow rates on the Columbia were reported as 79% of normal. Wouldn't a more typical year be a more fair way to establish a benchmark for evaluating the Canadian entitlement?
The flow rate doesn't establish the Canadian entitlement. In the past, as I explained, it's a very complex calculation based on assumptions that were established in the 1960s. So what we've done now is we've fixed the Canadian entitlement, and it's not associated with flow rate, and it's not associated with power generation in the United States, except when we use some of the million acre feet for our own purposes. So there is not a connection between the 2024 flow rate and the Canadian entitlement.
Thanks, Kathy. Jeff, do you have another question for us?
Yes. Do the residents of Kootenay Lake Reservoir understand the connection between the redredging of Groman Narrows and the need for Duncan storage? Could the redredging of Groman Narrows make it possible to remove Duncan Dam?
The short answer to that is no. Dredging of Groman Narrows is not a treaty issue. However, it's been looked at from time to time, and there are potentially as many impacts as they may be. There may be benefits. So that is not being considered. And the volume, just from an engineering perspective, the volume of water that could go through Groman, if it were to be dredged, doesn't come close to the amount of flood mitigation that Duncan provides.
Thanks, Kathy. Let's go with a couple more written questions, and then we can move over to raised hands again. Jeff, another question, please.
Yes, the non-treaty storage agreement that managed the extra 5 million acre feet of non-treaty water in the Kinbasket Reservoir just expired. Who will decide what to do with this water next and how?
Well, it has expired. It's not it's not treaty storage. It's 5 million acre feet of non-treaty storage, as the name indicates. It has expired. It's a commercial agreement between BC Hydro and Bonneville Power Administration. My understanding is that it's not being renewed at this time, but the next year or two it will be used to refill the accounts, the storage accounts for the non-treaty storage agreement.
Thanks, Kathy.
Maybe I could add that whatever future non-treaty storage agreement is concluded, if there is another one, it will have to be compliant with the new treaty.
Great. Thanks. Jeff, you have one more?
Yes, this is related to fish species. Pike have been introduced to the Kootenay system in Montana, Idaho, and Northeast Washington, and there have been Herculean efforts to try to eradicate from the boundary dam. What is being planned to keep invasive species such as pike, bass, and mysid shrimp from expanding throughout the basin further?
Thanks, Jeff. Kathy, go ahead.
That's a fish management question. That's not an AIP question. Sorry, Mindy.
Great. Maybe another one? Go ahead, Jeff.
Yes. Many dams in the USA are being removed. When are you going to remove the Arrow Dam, as in reality, it has not been needed for flood control since Micah and Libby were built?
Well, Arrow is actually the most effective flood storage in the system. There are years where half of the entire volume coming down from through Keenly side is coming down from the Arrow Lakes watershed itself, and half is coming down from, you know, through Mica and Revelstoke. So it does provide an important function for flood risk management to the U.S. for sure, but also to Castle Garden Trail.
Great, thank you. So I'm skimming through some of the questions, and I'm going to select one. And it might have been addressed, but I think the way the question is phrased will help clarify some things. But one is, it's about the Kootenai Transboundary Working Group again. Will membership include non-government and non-Indigenous representation from local communities or from environmental interests? Who would like to answer that question? Maybe Jamie or Kathy.
I can start, and then Jamie can jump in, because I was involved in helping develop the concept with many others. It will by, I think, necessity involve broader number of stakeholders and affected people, because there are synergies that can happen with other programs that exist today that in combination with considerations on Libya operations can have much more benefit to both countries than if they were looked at in isolation. So communities being affected and local governments, Tanaka have been very much front and center, but also provincial agencies or ministries, and Kootenai Tribe of Idaho, for example, and many others. So it's we're still, as Jamie mentioned, working on the terms of reference, but the intention is to be not unwieldy, but inclusive of people's interests. What that's going to look like, we don't know yet.
Go ahead, Jamie.
Thank you so much, Brooke. Great question. And just a small little addition to Kathy's point is, we definitely have been working very hard on working with the partners in the area around Kookanoosa. And it's a very important part of our traditional territory, and mine particularly. I'm from the community of Yakutak Nakshiat, which the Kookanoosa is right adjacent to. So just letting you know that we are very much involved in this work, and are very much wanting to ensure that all stakeholders' views are represented in the work that happens and any decisions that happened in operations, as we provide recommendations to the Army Corps of Engineers. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Jamie. Jeff, maybe we'll go back to you for another question. Do you have one queued up?
Yes, and I'm actually grabbing this from the chat because it's different than any of the other questions, and probably a lot of people would be interested in it. Will the upcoming U.S. elections impact the future of the CRT? Donald Trump referred to the river and Canada as a faucet he could turn on. Should Canadians be concerned if the treaty isn't modernized until after the elections?
So as a public servant, not my place to weigh in on political considerations, but I think it's helpful if I say that we've negotiated with the United States on a modernized colonial treaty under three different presidents so far. We did not feel any disruption during the changes in administration. We believe that this is a good treaty, amended treaty for both countries. So based on that belief, I don't see why any country or the US would walk away from it. And negotiations carried on under the former President Trump. So that's perhaps the best I can offer. And of course, Stephen should have more to say as the Canadian lead negotiator.
Yeah, thanks. I think actually Kathy captured most of what I would have said, but only in the sense that we have had very good negotiations with both the we've been doing this since 2018. We've already gone through two administrations. Won't comment on the U.S. elections, and that's up to them, and the outcome will be as it is, but we expect to continue good collaboration no matter who the next president is, no matter what the next administration is. And that's essentially where we think we're going on this.
Thanks very much, Kathy and Steve. I think we have time for one or two more questions before we'll share some kind of closing comments and next steps on how you can continue to learn and provide your feedback. So Jeff, do you have another question queued up for us?
Yes, on another different topic. With continued global warming, our late summer glacial runoff is expected to peak and then rapidly fall off. How have our treaty agreements planning to take into account the resulting very low river flows likely within 10 to 50 years in the headwaters of the Columbia, especially late in the summer and early fall?
Thanks. Good question. And very concerning question by everybody. The snowpack is predicted to be lower generally going forward. However, more precipitation will come in the form of rainfall. And so there seems to be a general consensus that in the Upper Columbia, the total inflow will be the same or maybe even slightly greater in on the Canadian Columbia Basin. That doesn't mean that we won't see higher potential flood risk and greater droughts in the summer, but that's the kind of modeling that we're doing to forecast and incorporate climate change predictions over the longer term not only in the flexibility and specified operations, but this is something that the operators, BC Hydro and US Army Corps of Engineers, do all the time. In a particular year, of course, the operators will try to, especially on the flood side, minimize any flood risk with the tools that they have. Going forward, it is going to be part of the adaptive management element of the joint ecosystem and Indigenous cultural values. And that adaptive management framework is being developed. It's also being developed on the Canadian side for our domestic flexibility to also incorporate what climate changes may mean for what we're trying to recover from an ecosystem perspective.
Thanks very much, Kathy. So I think we have time for one more question before we start wrapping up. Jeff, one more?
Sure, and this actually is specific to adaptive management. Why does the AIP continue to rely on fixed quantities of water without regard to the real-time conditions or situational awareness necessary for adaptive management?
Well, actually, the fixed volume of water is not a monolith. It can be used during certain times of the year, during certain seasons. It can be used depending on whether it's a wet year, a normal year, a dry year. So there's nothing really fixed about it. The operations under those circumstances definitely consider what is predicted to occur, but also in year, there will be opportunities to vary from what what operation is being planned, say in November, December, January, February, and then seeing that something else is happening, and the adaptive management component will be able to look at how to address any unforeseen changes that are not part of the planning for the operations, either for the CRT operations for power, but also for the operations for ecosystems.
Great. And you know what? There's one point of clarification that's just popped into the Q&As that maybe we can lead off with. The person was asking for clarity on what 1 million acre feet of water equals, asking if it's eight, did he hear 8 feet of water? Is that right? So 1 million acre feet equals 8 feet of elevation on Arrow. Am I right on that?
Correct. Yeah.
There you go. All right, everyone. Thank you so much for all of your questions and for your patience as we moved through the presentations. I know many of you would love it if it was just an open question period, and we have a certain amount of information to get out, but really appreciate you hanging out until this time. We will continue to update our materials on our website to continue to provide information about the agreement in principle. And sorry, my lighting is making a little off, on and off here. It's sounding me off the stage. So I do want to thank our speakers for tonight and for their presentations to negotiate with the United States. I also want to thank the folks who have been helping us in the background, Aaron and Jeff, and for all of you listening in and sticking around. Like I said, the recording will be on our website in the next few days, and we'll send an email around to everyone to let you know when it's up. And I wanted to take a minute to share next steps in our public engagement. So as Kathy mentioned earlier, we have a number of resources on our website that I believe Jeff just put into the chat there, a link to our webpage. We have this overview video, which is 30 minutes, much shorter than this info session, covering the highlights of the AIP. There's on the opposite end of the spectrum, there is a document containing the content of the agreement in principle, if you want to dive deeper, as well as a backgrounder summarizing the elements and frequently asked questions. We'll continue to update the FAQs and provide more information on the AIP there. But we want to hear your feedback. Ways that you can provide your feedback are to email us, first of all. We've also just today launched an online questionnaire that we will send you all a link to. It's on our website. You can fill out the questionnaire. There's also guidelines for written submissions if you'd like to submit a formal written submission of feedback. And later on in the year, as Kathy mentioned, we are planning to hold community meetings throughout the Canadian portion of the basin. So we encourage you to please attend those and share your feedback with us at that time. You can stay up to date on all of our activities by checking in on the website, following us on Facebook or Twitter/X, and or subscribing to email updates. And we'll share a slide at the end of this session with all of the resources for how to connect with us on those platforms. So I think that pretty much brings us to the end. Just another heartfelt thank you to everyone. I know this is a really meaningful, that's, you know, even a lighthearted word. It means a great deal to many of you and to us as well. And just really thank you for your attention, for your interest, and for your questions. I will wish you a very good evening, and I'm sure we'll be speaking to many of you in the near future. Thank you very much.